So in the end of the first video in this series, we've added some very simple jumping logic. And one thing about this implementation is that if you hold space, you will just keep on jumping. You never have to actually let go of space. And it could be fine, some games actually allow it. But for this controller, we're gonna fix it. And another thing that you may notice about this implementation is that we can only jump when we are grounded this exact frame. So when we jump off ledges, for example, it's very easy to miss the perfect timing. It's better to be forgiving and give the player the ability to jump even after the controller has lost ground. So if you press the spacebar, let's say 100 milliseconds later, it's still fine. It will just feel less clunky. But also, when we are walking down steep slopes, unless we're applying enough downforce, we usually don't have ground either. Because we're walking a little bit forward, then we're falling, then we're walking a little bit forward again and falling a little bit again, and so we're almost never grounded. Which means that we can't jump while walking down slopes. And another problem that is kind of the opposite of this one is that if we hit space right before touching the ground, we won't jump. And it doesn't matter if we were like 10 milliseconds early or like 5 milliseconds early, it doesn't matter, we need ground to jump. So it would be a much nicer and much smoother experience if we remember the last time the player tried to jump. And if it wasn't too long ago, we can still jump when we hit the ground. So let's create a new script and call it player jumping. This script is going to require our player script because it's kind of like a module. Here we're going to grab the reference to our player script in awake, and we're going to take the jump speed field from the player script and move it to this script. And in the player script, we won't be needing the jump action anymore, and we can remove the jumping logic as well. And in fact, this script won't be needing a reference to the jump action either. If you look at the input component here, you'll see that it says here that it will send the onJump message. And it makes sense to use it for this script. So let's create a new Boolean variable called trying to jump and set it to true when we're trying to jump. On before move, we can check if we're trying to jump and that player is grounded. And if that's the case, we can add vertical velocity and set trying to jump back to false. Now, as you can see, controller is actually private and I don't really want to expose it without a reason. So instead, let's just add a property isGrounded to the player. And we can use it in our jumping script like so. And of course, on enable, let's register our onBeforeMove method for the event. And on disable, let's unregister it. And now we're only jumping once after we press the spacebar. Now you may be wondering why we need the onBeforeMove event at all here. Why can't we just put this code in the onJump directly like this? And the reason, of course, is the execution order. We're actually resetting the vertical velocity on update in our player script. So we need this velocity change to happen after the gravity is processed and before the controller is moved. So let's fix the problem with having to time our jumps perfectly when we're bunny hopping. Let's add a new float called jump press buffer time and a new float for the last jump press time. On jump, we're gonna set it to the current time, and on before move, we're gonna make a variable called was trying to jump. If we were trying to jump no longer than jump press buffer time seconds ago, we're gonna consider it true. And now instead of checking if we're trying to jump this exact frame, we're gonna check if we're trying to jump this frame or if we were trying to jump recently. And now it feels much more satisfying because we don't have to time our jumps perfectly. If we're 30 milliseconds early, it's still fine. Now to fix the problem with the slopes and ledges, instead of checking whether or not we pressed the spacebar recently, we're gonna check if we were grounded recently or not. Let's go to our player script and let's add a new private Boolean variable wasGrounded. On update before everything else, we're gonna call the updateGround method. And in this method, we're gonna check if isGrounded is not what it was. And if it isn't, we're gonna update the wasGrounded variable and we're gonna call some event so that whoever is interested in this change can react to it. So let's create a new public event onGroundStateChange. As you can see, it takes one Boolean argument, which is gonna be our current ground state. And let's call it here. In our jumping script, let's create a new float called lastGroundedTime and a new serialized float for the groundGrazedTime. On groundStateChange, we're gonna check if we are currently not grounded, and if we're not, we're gonna assign currentTime to the lastGroundedTime. Let's actually register it for the event. And just like we tested before for the was trying to jump, now we can test for was grounded. And if we are grounded now or if we were grounded recently, it means that we can jump. There is a problem with this code, though. If you run this and press space, you'll just fly straight into the outer space. And if you're making a space exploration game, it might be alright. But if you're making a boring Call of Duty clone, you probably want to fix that. The problem, of course, is that was trying to jump and was grounded are both true for more than one frame. So was trying to jump should only be valid if we're also grounded. And now with all of these changes, it's working as expected. And it's starting to feel less scuffed and more like what you would get in an actual game.